Good evening, Midway family. I'm so glad you are joining us tonight. I am Grant and my beautiful wife, Michelle, and we are just here for our Wednesday night devotion tonight. We are going to be in the book of Colossians, continuing in the book of Colossians. And so if you have your Bible tonight, open up to the book of Colossians, and we're going to be starting tonight in verse 24 here in a few moments. And just a reminder, the book of Colossians is written by the Apostle Paul. He is in a Roman prison, and while Paul's in this Roman prison, he sends this letter with Epaphras, who is probably the pastor of this church, and Paul is concerned about this church, concerned because this church was believing a lot of lies, concerned because this church was believing a lot of false truths that were coming in from the outside and really pulling them away from the Lord, which is always a battle to us not to believe lies, but to believe the word of truth. And so Paul is writing to this church and letting them know the truths that are in God's word. And so we've been in Colossians for a few weeks. Last week we covered a few verses. So Michelle, why don't you take us through just a recap maybe of what we looked at last week and then pray for us. And then we're going to jump in tonight, verse 24.
Okay, awesome. So if you were with us last week, we did read verses 13 to 23. We just covered 10 verses. And so I'm going to just share with you verse 13, okay? He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. That's just such a powerful verse. That's where we kicked off, talking about how God has delivered us, rescued us. Amen. We were under the power of darkness. Now we're in God's kingdom. When we become a Christian, when you put your faith and trust in Christ, you're out of the hands of the power of darkness. You're in God's kingdom, the kingdom of the Son of His love, who is Jesus Christ. And then it goes on to talk more about Jesus Christ. So we're going to see in the next 10 verses, it talks about how Jesus delivered us, mm-hmm. He created us, He reconciled us to Himself, and that He is the head of the church. And then if you get all the way down here, it's going to talk about, it says that in all things He may have the preeminence. Mm-hmm. And that means in all things, Jesus reigns supreme. Yes. In all things, okay? And then the very last verse that we covered last week, verse 23, Paul encourages us to continue in the faith. So that's what he wants us to do. And right now at this time, we've got to continue in the faith. So now we're going to pick up in verse 24.
Yeah. No, thanks, Bev. So much. You want to pray for us, and we're going to jump in tonight.
Yes. Let's do it. Yes. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you so much for this scripture. We thank you for the book of Colossians. We thank you for the Apostle Paul writing this letter while he was in prison and suffering. God, many of us are suffering right now. Many of us don't understand why we're going through this, and these words can encourage us. They can bless our heart. So God, we just pray for each person on the other side of that screen, whoever's watching. God, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, God, that you would encourage them, that you would use this scripture to uplift them and to help them open their eyes to see you for who you are, Jesus, that you reign supreme in all things. And God, we just ask you to bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Michelle, so much. I do love that. It's about him, for him. Mm-hmm. He reigns supreme. I love that text. And so we pick up in verse 24. Here's what it says. This is Paul. He says, I now rejoice in my sufferings for you. That phrase right there, if you circle in your Bible, circle that phrase right there, I now rejoice. The Apostle Paul would rejoice in his sufferings and through his difficulties he would go through because he knew there was a greater purpose. And listen, I'm telling you right now, I believe that there's a greater purpose right now. That there's COVID-19 and there's a lot of devastation and a lot of difficulties, but I think God is doing something great in this time. We just don't always see it. But Paul trusts in that. He says, I rejoice in my sufferings for you and fill up in my flesh what is lacking in the afflictions of Christ. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. For the sake of his body, which is the church. So Paul says that he says, I rejoice in my sufferings for something that's lacking for the sake of the body, which is the church. So what Paul's saying is there's some things we have to go through. Mm-hmm. Sometimes there's some things that we have to go through to get us to be all that God wants us to be. Now, that's an interesting passage. And what's important is we understand that in this passage, Paul's not saying that Christ's suffering wasn't sufficient. He's not saying that it was complete. I read in a commentary, and I wanted to read from John Phillips' commentary. I love the way that he puts it. So in that specific passage, lacking in the afflictions of Christ, here's what he says. Christ's sufferings are of two kinds. Christ has suffered for our sins, and that suffering took place on the cross, and that suffering is over forever. He died, he rose again, and he has ascended on high. Now Christ suffers with his saints, and that suffering goes on and on. Christ suffered for our sins. That's a redemptive suffering. That's on the cross of Calvary. And now Christ suffers with his saints. This is a responsive suffering. So what Paul is saying here, he's saying there's some things that we have to go through, but when we're going through those things, we're not alone.
Yeah.
We're not alone. Yeah. That Christ is with us. He's going to drive this point home in a couple verses from now, that we're not alone. Christ's sacrifice on the cross is complete. But now as we suffer, Christ is with us. The Father is with us, that he suffers with us. You know, I spent some time in the hospital a few weeks ago. We talked about it a lot. Still so thankful for everybody that was praying.
Yeah.
And while that was difficult, what's more difficult than being in the hospital is watching your children be in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Three of our kids, Daniel, Abigail, and Hannah, have all spent time in the hospital. Isaac's been in the emergency room a few times, but mm-hmm. at different seasons, we've had some difficult things through some surgeries and through some other things. And to me, that's harder as a parent. And I remember some of you guys know I don't like germs, and so I'm a big hand washer, which you wouldn't know it because of what I got sick. But wash my hands. I'm big into not drinking after people, and I remember Hannah being in the
Except
hospital.
Except me, you drink after me.
I do
me.
Drink after you. Yeah. That's true. I do drink after Michelle. But you know, I remember Hannah being in the hospital,
mm-hmm.
and there was in the ICU, so there was no beds. If you remember this, there was no chair,
yeah.
and me and you like laying on the floor,
yeah,
like
taking turns
being in the ICU, and we never left our side, and we would just lay on the floor in the ICU, which to me is that not a place I normally would probably lay in a hospital. But because my daughter was going through something, we laid right there.
Yeah.
I remember Abigail having surgery and she was younger and they put her to sleep. And I remember honestly us fighting with that anxiousness because
yeah.
this is our baby mm-hmm. and they're going to put her to sleep. And I remember them wheeling her back for surgery. And I don't think she was that anxious. She might have been for a little girl, but they put her to sleep. But that was like a long hour and a half for us
yeah.
as we're waiting in the waiting room while she's going through this surgery. She had some oral surgery. And I say all that to say, When our family members go through something, when your family members go through, there's a suffering that takes place with us, an angst because of your love for them. And what Paul is saying here is that God has that for us.
Yeah.
That the afflictions that we're going through for the sake of his body, the church, that there's things we're going through, but we're going to see God is with us even in those things.
Yep.
First Peter says this, after suffering comes glory.
Mm.
That's what First Peter says. Think about it. Jesus dies on the cross and now he's glorified. Sometimes we have to go through some things, suffer some things, but afterwards is glory. The psalmist says it this way in Psalms 30. Let me just read it very quickly. He says, I will extol you. This is Psalm 30, 1 through 5. I will extol or praise you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and hast not made my foes to rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried unto thee, and thou hast healed me. O Lord, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. Thou hast kept me alive, that I should not go down into the pit. Sing unto the Lord, O saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. For his anger endures for a moment, in his favor is life. Here we go. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning.
Mm.
He says, there's things that we're going through, and it's going to be a hard night. It's going to be a difficult season, but joy comes in the morning, and we have to remember that joy. I love that he uses that word remembrance. Give remembrance of his holiness. I'm going to remember what he's done, and I'm looking forward to what he's going to do while I'm here right now.
Yeah.
Joy comes in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
But Paul's including them in this. He's connecting them. Again, remember, Paul says, I rejoice and I'm in prison. So Paul's not writing this book from the Bahamas. He's not on a cruise saying, hey, suck it up. He's in a Roman prison. And we'll see in a moment, striving, having a hard time. Verse 25, he says, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God, which was given me for you to fulfill the word of God. Paul says, I'm stewarding this. God has given, he's placed this on me to steward it. Why? To fulfill the word of God. He says that what I'm going through is a purpose. There's a purpose. I'm a steward of it. God has put something on us. A few weeks ago in our family, God had stewarded us with something. How are we going to steward it?
Yeah.
How are we going to steward this suffering, this difficulty? We're separated. I'm sick. Michelle's not feeling well. The kids, we're going through. How are we going to handle that? You know what we're going to do? We're going to declare the works of the Lord.
Yeah.
I want to steward it for God's glory. And I'm going to point him to praise in the difficult days, in the hard days, in the good days. I'm going to give him praise. This is what he's saying in this passage of scripture. Verse 26, this is a great passage of scripture. It's tricky, but it's great. Verse 26 says this, the mystery, he says, I'm gonna steward the what I'm going through to fulfill the word of God. The mystery, if you underline in your Bible, verse 26, underline the word, the mystery, the two words there, which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. Paul says there's a mystery. There's something that everyone doesn't know, and now it's being revealed. I want to share just a few things. Listen, God's always kept some secrets.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's a lot of things that we don't know because we're not God.
Yeah. Right.
There's a lot of things that sometimes we can really beat ourselves up against the wall if we're going to try to understand everything. Mm. You're just not going to understand everything. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things that when specifically our kids were younger, we didn't tell our kids because they just wouldn't understand and they couldn't understand. And we just didn't tell them because we're the mom, we're the dad, we understand, they don't.
Right.
And God, our Heavenly Father, is painting on a canvas bigger than we can imagine. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. And so there's some things that He just doesn't tell us. Deuteronomy 29:29 says this, the secret things belong to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Like the secret things. There's some things that we're not going to understand. That's the first thing I want us to know when He talks about this idea of a mystery. But then secondly, there's some things that God reveals to His saints, to believers, that everybody doesn't know or understand. There's some things that He tells us that everyone doesn't understand. Psalm 25 says this, the secret of the Lord is with them that hear Him. The secret of the Lord is with them that hear Him. There's some things that we understand when we are enlightened to the truths that are found in God's Word that we're going to understand that a person without the Lord is not going to know. Proverbs 3:32 says this, His secret is with the righteous. There's some things that He gives to His children. There's things that my kids know about me that nobody else knows, right? Mm-hmm. There's some things. Michelle's got some stuff about Pastor Grant that nobody else knows, and we're not going to tell, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, but there's some things as a family, right, that your family knows. But as God's children, there's things that He reveals to us that not everyone knows. And those are those that believe in God. But then lastly is there's some things that God has hidden in the past. This is what Paul's talking about here. The mystery which was hidden from ages and generations, but has now been revealed to the saints. In the Old Testament, there's things that God didn't share, but now in the New Testament, they're revealed. And what's revealed? We're going to see what's revealed right here. He says, the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from all generations has now been revealed to His saints. There's this mystery that the people of the Old Testament were looking forward to. They didn't fully understand. They're looking forward to it. Now it's revealed, verse 27, to them God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Here's the mystery. Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is what Paul's saying. In the Old Testament, they knew the Messiah was coming. They were waiting on this Messiah, and they missed that Jesus came in their midst and died on the cross. They thought this Messiah was going to come to rule and reign. Instead, He came down and laid His life, the scripture says, a ransom for many. And now the Bible says He doesn't dwell in these tabernacles, but He dwells inside of us. Yeah. He says, in you, the hope of glory. Underline that phrase in your Bible. Christ in you, the hope of glory. What they never fully knew was this Messiah would come and He would live in His people. And this is why Paul is able to rejoice. Because while Paul is in prison, he's never alone. Mm-hmm. Listen, while you're at home by yourself right now, maybe you're at home by yourself and you have no one with you right now. Listen, you are never alone. Christ in you, the hope of glory. You're not alone. And Paul's writing to them like, you're going to go through some things and you're going to suffer, but God has a purpose and God has a plan. And listen, Christ is in you, the hope of glory. And not only that, He's for you. Like you have a concern when your kid struggles or suffers, the God of the universe has a concern when His children suffers, and He's right there with us. We are not alone. Christ with us. Christ for us. And so because of that, Paul's going to endure, and because of that, we need to endure. Mm-hmm. It's just a powerful, powerful scripture. Mm-hmm. So you want to take us through these next couple verses?
Yeah,
just love it.
I love that. Just at the end of 27, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Mm-hmm. You know, our hope is also that one day we're going to be with Christ.
Yes.
Christ is in us, but one day we're going to be in heaven with Him. That's the hope that we can have, knowing that we are God's and He is ours, that this world is not the end, that there's more to this life than just this life.
That's right.
You know, so we know we have hope in Christ. And the Bible says, the scripture says that that hope is the anchor for our souls. Mm-hmm. Right now, our souls need an anchor. Mm-hmm. We need something that's going to hold us when the storms of life are tossing us to and fro. And the hope of Jesus is what that anchor is.
It is
the hope of Christ in you, the hope of glory. Mm. I love that. Okay, then look in verse 28. Him we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. So the Apostle Paul saying, Christ in you, the hope of glory, and then Him we preach. So Paul is saying that very Christ that is in you, that's who we're preaching about. That's who we're teaching about. talking about himself, talking about all the other disciples and all the other followers of Christ that were preaching at the time. That's who we preach about. Him we preach. So Paul is preaching, but he's also doing more than that. He's warning. Now, why would the apostle Paul need to preach, but then also warn? Well, he needs to warn about the lies of the enemy.
That's right.
Some of the Christians there may be believing lies of the enemy. Mm-hmm. We need to warn the people, just as a good father or a good mother will warn their children, mm-hmm. hey, watch out for this. Hey, watch out for that. Hey, you haven't thought about this. Well, so the apostle Paul, being a fatherly figure, a spiritual father to these churches, is going to warn them, hey, watch out for this. Watch out for the lies of the enemy. Watch out. Your sin is going to have consequences, mm-hmm. and they're going to be way more than you thought. So mm-hmm. don't go down that road. Don't go down that path that you think, it's not going to be that bad. Paul is saying we've got to warn others. He set the example for us, preaching, then warning every man. And now every man here is mentioned three times, but that's not talking specifically to just a man. That's talking about to mankind. Warn mankind. It's talking about warning every person. Mm-hmm. And then teaching every man in all wisdom. So teaching in wisdom, if you skip down to Colossians 2:3, look what it says here. In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom mm-hmm. and knowledge, talking about Christ. So without Christ, we cannot have true wisdom. We can have knowledge, but we can't have true wisdom without Christ. It all begins with him. And so he's saying we're going to preach Christ and we're going to warn people. We're going to teach every man in all wisdom. True wisdom is only found in Jesus Christ, but its use, wisdom is the right use of knowledge. So we can have all this knowledge, but if we don't have Christ, we can't have that true wisdom.
So good.
So teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. You know, the only way we can be perfect, seen as perfect, is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, he covers our sin with his blood. We can't be perfect in and of ourselves. Mm-mm. We're not perfect. We've got up today, we've already made mistakes. We've already said, oh, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, I shouldn't have done this. All right. So we're not perfect. And we know you're not either. None of us are. And that's why Christ came and died, so that he could offer his blood to cover
Amen.
All of our sins, the little sins, the big, the things that we do that are really, really wrong, that are evil, that are bad. He wants to present us perfect. Now, also perfect there can also mean fully mature and spiritually mature. So it's important that the Apostle Paul, he's teaching, he's preaching, he's warning, because he wants his disciples, the people that are listening to his teaching, to become spiritually mature mm-hmm. and that they are ready to train others, that they're fully trained and now they're ready to train others. And that's our hope for the church mm-hmm. is that you guys, all of you watching, that you're going to grow in your spiritual maturity, that you're not going to stay a baby Christian. You know, mm-hmm. God wants you to take those steps just like a child, a little child would grow mm-hmm. and they would get to the point where they can do things for you. I'll just give you an example. One example, my daughter, Abigail, when she was little, she liked to help me bake. Well, she would help me. Well, now she's grown. She can drive to the grocery store. She can buy all the groceries. She can cook the whole meal. She can do everything all by herself. Amen. Praise God. So it's a wonderful blessing for the last couple of weeks for us.
Specifically, yeah.
Because, as you know, Grant was in the hospital and I wasn't feeling well myself. And so God just used her as such a blessing mm-hmm. to bless us during that time. Now she's able to do the whole thing I used to do in the kitchen. She's able to buy the food, cook the food, prepare the food, clean it up. Well, this is what Paul is saying. He's saying, hey, it's time for you guys to rise up to that spiritual maturity so you're able to do all of this without my help. And so he wants to present every man perfect, spiritually mature, not perfect in action, but spiritually mature in Christ Jesus. To this end, I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. So Paul is saying, hey, I'm in a Roman prison, but I'm still laboring and striving. Now laboring, he's working. He's writing letters. He's also laboring and striving in prayer. Yeah. So striving can mean like an athlete running. Mm-hmm. They're pressing. They're giving it everything that they've got. They're craning their neck toward that finish line. They can see it. Mm-hmm. And they are just pushing themselves to the point of exhaustion. Yeah. To finish the race. And that's what the Apostle Paul was doing. He says, I'm striving according to his working, which works mightily in me. So even though the Apostle Paul was preaching, teaching, warning, he's making disciples, he's laboring, he's working, he's striving, he's doing it all through the mighty power of God. He's not doing it in his own strength. Look, if you underline, which works in me mightily, so his working. Paul is working, but God is also working. Mm-hmm. It's a partnership.
It's good.
Paul is partnering with God. And if you do anything in life, whatever it is, raising your children, having a marriage, going to work, maybe you're in the medical community. Maybe you're working so hard right now. Maybe you've got more pressure on you than you've ever had in your life. We want you to know we're praying for you. Our team is praying for you. And we know you've got so much on you. But you need to invite God, just like Paul partnered with God. Say, God, I need your help. I cannot do anything without you, and I need your help to help me right now to be able to do what you've called me to do during this specific time. So the Apostle Paul, everything he was doing, he was working through God's mighty power. Ephesians 6:10 says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might.
Yes.
Anything we do has to be through God's mighty power. We invite God, God, please help me. God, please help me be able to do what you have called me to do during this specific time. Mm. And so we want to encourage you, whatever you're doing for God. Maybe you've got a whole house full of children that are running around and you're like, when is this quarantine going to end? Maybe you're healthy and you just wanted a little encouragement tonight. Maybe you're lonely and you're sitting there thinking, I need God's power to encourage me. Mm-hmm. Maybe like we said, you're working. Maybe you're working in a grocery store. Maybe you're working in the medical industry. Whatever you're doing, invite God to come in and help you and enable you, equip you, empower you to do whatever you're doing with his mighty power. You need it. We need it.
We do.
Our church needs it. We need God's power in us now more than ever before.
That's right.
So, dear friend, do that. Ask God to help you. I know that he will. I know he will enable you like he did the Apostle Paul, his mighty power working in you.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's so good, babe. I love that. Spiritual maturity sometimes comes through suffering as you tie those together.
Yeah.
Like there's some things that God wants to make us perfect, but you're not going to be able to do it had you not gone through this.
Right.
And so there's this connection that takes place of sometimes you have to go through some things, but in that we get to a place we never would have gotten possible. It's a no pain, no gain situation.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you have to go through things. And for a lot of you right now, you're going through some things right now, and God's going to put some things in you as long as we trust in him. And how are we going to do that? I love in him, Philippians 4, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can't do all things. Michelle can't do all things, but you know what? Right. Through Christ, we can do all things. We can do all things. You know, my question, I guess, for us tonight is, do you know the hope of glory, Jesus Christ? Do you know Jesus? Are you trying to do things on your own? The Apostle Paul was preaching this, that Jesus came to the earth, that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, and that Jesus Christ rose from the grave 3 days later. That's the gospel. Wow. When Paul says, this is who we preach, him we preach, 28, that's what he's preaching, that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and for my sins. And by faith, we receive the gift of salvation, and then Christ lives in us. Can I ask you a question today? Have you ever put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior? The Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave a gift. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten, his one and only son, that whoever believes him, puts their faith in him, should not perish, but have everlasting life. God offers the free gift of salvation. This is the mystery that was talked about before, that Jesus would come, that he would die on the cross, that he would dwell in us, and he offers that gift to you tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you found this tonight and you're watching it, or you see it at another time and you've never heard that before, but friend, listen, God loves you.
Mm-hmm.
God loves you, and God has a purpose through what you're going through. And maybe for some of you, you're watching tonight and you never would have watched, but because of everything we're going through, you're watching, and God wants you to know this, he loves you and he gave his son Jesus. You might be thinking, well, why did Jesus have to die on the cross for me? The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us have sinned. We've all fallen short. No one's perfect. Michelle's not perfect. I'm not perfect. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. The scripture says the wages of sin is death. What we've earned because of our sin is death, a separation from God. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God offers you a gift tonight. He offers you a gift, the gift of salvation, if you will receive it freely. A lot of people think, well, I'm going to be a good person and I'm going to go to church and I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this. And then when I get to heaven, maybe God will accept me because how good of a person. The scripture says we can't be good enough. Our righteousness compared to a holy God is filthy, the scripture says. But the Bible also says, and I love this, God gave his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Even though you're not perfect, even though you've made mistake after mistake, God knows everything about you. And he sent Jesus to die on the cross for you. And he offers you this gift of salvation if you will receive it by faith. If you'll receive it by faith, right where you are tonight, if you're listening to my voice tonight and you don't know for sure if you died, heaven would be your home. Would you pray this prayer with me right where you are? I'm going to pray with you. But if you don't know, if you died today, you'd spend eternity in heaven. But you know you're a sinner. You know you're not perfect. And you want the gift of salvation. It's freely offered, the scripture says, by faith. Let's bow our heads. I'm going to pray with you and lead you through what we call the sinner's prayer. This is me giving you the words to say, to express to a God that loves you, that sent his son to die for you. Would you pray this prayer? Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need you. Right where you're seated, just pray that prayer. Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need you. I believe you died in my place and I want to receive you right now as my Savior. Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. I believe that you alone are the Lord, and I surrender all of me to you right now. Just pray that prayer. Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. By faith, please forgive me. I believe that you are the Lord, and I surrender all of me to you right now. Father, I pray you will bless those that prayed that prayer tonight. Work in their life in a powerful way. I pray for our church family, Father, that you will bless them and strengthen them. Help them to realize what they are going through has a purpose and that you are good and that you are right there with us. Lord, I pray your blessings over them. I pray you'll help us to continue to do what Paul says, that he will continue to strive, that he will continue to work, Lord, and labor according to the working which works in us mightily. We love you, Father, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Listen, friend, Christ is with us. He's for us. He's suffering right there with us. Do not give up. God is working. And we are one day closer to being together again. Love you guys so much.
We're praying for you.
Yes. God bless you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.